going on, guys? Welcome to another Lifestyle of Eden podcast with your host, Nick Tognetti, the founder of the functional nutrition practice, Lifestyle of Eden. Thank you guys for joining on this podcast today. And today I want to talk about something that I've had to utilize in my practice, but it has been a weak point of mine, if I'm just being very vulnerable with you. But ever since I started to pick it up and utilize it in every area of my life, it has been something that's greatly helped me. And it was actually a prophetic word that a man of God came up and spoke to me. And he said that if I started to apply these things, the Lord was going to bless my work. And it has to do with boundaries, right? And I talk about this quite a bit on my social medias. If you follow me on Instagram, lifestyle underscore of underscore Eden, or my Facebook, Nick Tognetti, I talk about this quite a bit. And when I talk about boundaries, you can apply this to any area of your life, right? So let's just start on a very practical level, like relationships. I see it all the time with men and women, all the time. And let me go ahead and just be vulnerable with you. I fell guilty of this for most of my life when it came to women. Okay. Is that a woman will do something that screws you over. She cheats on you, she lies to you, or she's just being sketchy and is just kind of toying along and, doing things that she wants to do. Or vice versa, right? If you're a woman and a guy is doing that to you. Well, what I end up seeing, and I end up having a couple really close friends that do this, and I have to be careful when I tell them that this is going on because it needs to be by the timing of the Lord. But I will see women do certain things to them, and then they stop, and then sure enough, days or weeks later, the woman will hit them back up, and they're immediately available to them. And I go, and I've told them, dude, this woman is continually hitting you up on her time, screwing you over, knowing she can hit you up whenever she wants. She's playing you like a fiddle. What it is, it's a lack of self-respect. It's a lack of boundaries. There should be a boundary that says, hey, when a man or woman does this, this is a red flag. I honor my boundaries and red flags, and they're done. This doesn't mean unforgiveness. You absolutely forgive always, but you fully hold the right and authority to be responsible for how close they can get to you in the next moment, right? There's got to be boundaries. Even parents hold boundaries. If I, as a father, buy my son a challenger for his first car, and I notice that he goes out, God forbid, drinks alcohol and wrecks the car, and he comes to me and apologizes, I'm absolutely going to forgive my son, just like the father forgives me. But I'm not going to go buy him another challenger. I have a boundary. Dude, you messed up. Like, I forgive you. I love you. But I'm not buying you another challenger. In fact, I'm probably not even going to buy you another car right now. You're going to have to save up for your own car. There's a consequence there. There's a boundary there. You have to have boundaries. And people talk about this all the time as psychologists, where they say the people with boundaries are always the most sought after and the most respected. And I talk about this like with Harvard, right? Harvard or Yale are not prestigious because of the people they produce. They are not prestigious because of how many applications they get. They are prestigious because of how many people they deny. How many people you get does not make you prestigious or top-notch. How many people you deny makes you prestigious or top-notch. And that goes with anything in life. So I've told people before, I'm a single man, and I've told people when it comes to women, listen, obviously I'm going to date a believer. But I've always told people, dating a believer is not good enough for me. If you're not baptized in the Holy Spirit and fire, there's a good chance we're probably not going to be together. And also, you have to be into fitness and health and nutrition, and you have to have a calling that's within ministry. Being a believer for me is not good enough. Do I think that that's great? Yes, but I have such high standards because of the calling on my life, and therefore it makes me prestigious in every area of my life. It doesn't make me better than other people, but it makes what I'm doing valued and sought after and respected. And so the same thing I always tell people, it goes with relationships, it goes with business. So with business, my booking calendar for consults and people wanting to sign up with Lifestyle of Eden is booked out almost every single week right now. Okay. Thank the Lord. But one thing I've had to realize is my practice is not for everybody. Why? Because I'm at this point where I'm getting so busy with clients where I really don't care to work with somebody that's not just 100% serious. If you're not really going to get results and bring value to Lifestyle of Eden and to your life and therefore to others, your money to me means nothing. It's very short term. Whether you pay me $300 a month or $700 a month, that's going to be spent on bills in a week. So your money doesn't really mean anything to me. It's short term, it vanishes. Like Proverbs says, it grows wings and flies away. I put no value on your money. The thing is, yeah, you may pay me $300, but now you're not changing your life and you're not affecting others. Meanwhile, somebody else that's very serious, they're paying me $300 or $700 or whatever it may be, but that's not the money that really is meaning something. It's the fact that because of their results, they are going and affecting other people and they bring me 10 more people. So now instead of that $700 they brought me, now it's $7,000 per month. So I always tell people, there are people whenever I have interviews with them and I go, hey, listen, I just had this conversation with a woman earlier this week. I said, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm not really sold on your devotion. It doesn't sound like you're really serious about making changes. It sounds like you're okay with where you're at. It sounds like you're okay with your health issues. And she goes, well, no, I'm not okay with it. And I go, well, listen, as we got on further, I go, I just don't really think my practice is for you. And we left it at that. It's not an angry thing, not a hateful thing, but you have to be real with people. Are they a good fit for your practice and are you a good fit for them? And so I've recognized this over time where at first, it was just like, man, I want to get more and more and more clients and this, that, or the other. But when you get more and more clients that are not fitting your vision and not very serious and that you can't really help, it just becomes a headache. And so because now people realize, dude, Nick expects a lot from his people. And not only just to get into my practice, but even once you're in my practice, I have boundaries. Every client of mine has updates that are scheduled for them. And you have to send me your updates by 9 a.m. Why? Because I am out of the office all the time doing stuff. I'm also a pastor. I'm also an author. I'm also filming all the time. And in order for me to best take care of my clients, I have to have boundaries, not just for me, but so that I can best serve you. And so I will have clients that will message me their updates after 9 a.m. And I tell them, sorry, it's after 9 a.m. Send me your update next week. There's boundaries there, and people respect those boundaries. Not only that, it's within the contracts that they sign with me when they start. And so I've learned to instill these boundaries, and people have learned to respect the business so much more and take their things more seriously. But like I said, I see this so many times in life, and especially in relationships. If people do something, like I had somebody one time, they said a really big lie to me. Really, really big. Not just small, like, oh, are you at the gym or did you work out this week? Yeah, I worked out and they didn't work out. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about life changing. And I forgave this person and I looked them in the eye and I said, listen, the book of Luke chapter 7, Jesus says, the person who is forgiven much loves much. And so I've been forgiven of so many abominations in my life and so much wickedness that it's so easy for me to forgive people. So I told this person, because this person said, I'm so surprised that you have not stormed away from me after what I lied to you about, and that you're not angry and vicious, and how are you talking so calm? And I'm just talking to them like this, just very calm, right? And I just looked at him, I said, and I started telling him, I said, the Lord has forgiven me of so much. I said, I forgive you. But I looked them in the eye and I said, if I ever find out that you lie to me ever again, I go, you will not be able to come near me. I go, I'll forgive you, but you will never come near me again. And they looked at me and they said, Nick, I will never lie to you, even down to something as small as what brand of toothpaste I use. And I said, thank you for that. But they respect me and they respect those boundaries that I have because I have to surround myself with people that are filled with integrity and people that respect themselves and this, that, or the other, because birds of a feather flock together. Like Paul says in Corinthians, I think it's 1 Corinthians 14, 33 or 15, 33. I always get this mixed up. But he says that do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good character. And so in everything that I do, relationships, business, friendships, I hold standards. I hold boundaries. And when you start to do this, you will notice your life will start to change in major ways. People will start to account you and whatever you're doing as prestigious. They will start to account you as the Yale or Harvard of whatever it is that you're doing. Like I said, remember, Yale and Harvard are not prestigious because how many applicants they get or who they produce. It's because of how many people they deny. because the standards are upheld at such a radical level. So guys, I hope that this starts to help you and starts to make you think about the areas of your life in marriage, with your kids, with your household, with your business, with your friendships. What standards are you holding? I've given you a few of mine, but now it's time for you to really look at the things that you have, because too many people do not have self-respect. And like I said, this was a rude awakening that I had to come across. I'm 30 now, but like at 28 years old, I had to really come across a revelation of, dude, I am just not really respecting myself. I'm allowing women or friends or people to do certain things, and I'm making excuses for it, why it's okay. Oh, well, no, they didn't mean this, or they have a good heart, or, well, no, you don't understand the situation. No, the fact of the matter is, this is what happened. When we start to use those excuses, know that you are being weak and that you are not making boundaries for yourself. And most importantly, you're not respecting yourself, and therefore you're not respecting the calling that God has on your life. Self-respect is an honor of what God has given to you and what he wants to do through you. So go and work on this, write these things down, and watch how this changes your life. Stay tuned for the next episode.